So finally, we have Alberto here, and he's going to talk us about the Squire, Neo4j, Mongo, Ruby, Scala, and what we should do. Let's be polyglot. So thank you very much.
Hi, thanks. So thank you for having me speak here. First, I introduce a bit myself. I co-founded a small company. We do consultancy. I'm living my dream. That means currently I'm living in the Canary Islands and working from there. And my background is the one of a web developer. So let's talk about Squire. Squire is an iPad application. It focuses on movies and TV shows. It's not the kind of complex application like IMDb, where you can look up a lot of data. But it's more of an app that suggests you which movies to watch, or you can suggest movies to friends, and so on. And it also knows on which services or streaming or hiring services you can watch that particular content. For example, Hulu, Vudu, or Netflix, or whatever. And if you have that app installed, it will also open that app so you can watch the movie. So the features, we have a very big database of movies and TV shows. We have info and price on the different services you have. We have social features like commenting and you can have contacts. You can import from your contacts. You can have friends and so on. And you can make recommendations, you can store comments, you can rate movies, obviously. You can suggest to a user, and you can have the system recommend you the next movies to watch. And I think what we did here is an unconventional approach. So a graph database purist would have probably modeled this in a way, and other guys would have done it with SQL or whatever, and I think we did a nice mix here. The ingredients are MongoDB, Neo4j, Ruby, and Scala. So the system overview is we have an iPad client. It could be any client. Actually, right now it's an iPad app, but it could be Android or web or whatever. We have a main API endpoint developed in Ruby, and we use MongoDB storage to store all the data. There we have everything, like your user profile, the movies, your ratings, comments, everything. And then, because we needed to provide recommendations, we thought Neo4j would be a great fit for that. So we wrote a recommendations engine on Scala on top of Neo4j. So why Scala? Because we can access the Neo4j core API really well from Scala. So it's Java, but being in Scala, it's really nice. So about the Ruby, about the main API, like I said, it's Ruby and MongoDB. It's REST plus JSON for the format. We have account sessions, movies, TV shows, contacts, ratings, user suggestions, recommendations, and then we have the recommendations engine within Scala. There we store, in Neo4j we store the IDs and the relationships of the movies and TV shows, the users obviously as well, and the ratings between them. So we needed to connect the two backends. We now have the API and it's working fine. We have the backend which can provide us the recommendations, but we need to connect them. So our first approach was to connect them via RabbitMQ. I don't know if you are familiar with RabbitMQ. It's an AMQP based implementation. It's a bus protocol and it's open. So RabbitMQ is one of those implementations, and RabbitMQ is very performant because it's reading in Erlang, So it's for that particular application, it's pretty good. So the flow right now is when the iPad asks for suggestions, we're talking here about suggestions coming from the system, not by the users. But you're asking the application to recommend you a movie. We receive the request in the main API. We transform the query params that we need in JSON, serialize them, and send a message over the RabbitMQ bus. And the recommendation engine in Scala receives that message, launches the query on the Neo4j database, and collects an array of results. So basically, it would be an array of IDs, of the IDs of the movies and TV shows you want to recommend. We pump that array on JSON through the RabbitMQ bus, and in the main API endpoint, we gather for all these IDs the data of the movie, do some transformation of the data, because obviously we don't want to send all that data, all that amount of data to the user. We transform that in JSON and send that back to the client. But there were a lot of issues with this approach. First, the API server is waiting while all this happens in Neo4j and the other backend. It's waiting and for the query to complete. Then when we get the results, we have to additionally query the MongoDB to gather the additional data we need to provide to the user. We need to transform that data. And while all that is happening, the Ruby server is blocking because it's not asynchronous. So that was that didn't work really well. And so our next approach was to communicate through the DB. So when the client now asks for suggestions, we receive the request on the main API endpoint. We validate the user against the MongoDB database. Is it a valid user? Okay, is he logged in and so on, a cookie. And then we transform the query params. We put the query params we need for the recommendations in a URL, plus an expiry time, plus a hash, and we cipher the whole params, the payload. So basically, we can know if the request has been tampered or if it's a valid request coming from the other backend, and we send a 301 redirect response to the client. So the client now goes to the recommendations engine following that URL. We can know if the URL is valid and coming from the other one because we are using the same private key, and we can validate the URL. We use the query params because they are stored in the URL. We can use them, launch the query on Neo4j, collect the IDs the same way we did before, but then we from the recommendations engine we query directly the MongoDB to retrieve all the data we need for the response, and we send the response to the client. And so there's another. So that's the only situation. That's not the only situation when the recommendation engine is accessing the MongoDB storage. There's also another situation, which is the graph reset, which I'll talk later about. So in the improvements of the solution is the Ruby server is not blocking anymore. It's a really fast response. So we just validate if you are validate your user and send you the response with the URL. So we moved the heavy lifting also into the Scala backend, which is sitting on Spray and it's asynchronous. And we also added an additional layer. So if we go back here, when we query the params to MongoDB, we also have a read-through cache. And with the transformed data already in the way we want to send it to the user. So if it's not there yet, we're driven for MongoDB, but if it's already there, we just use it as it is. It's read through, it stores the transformed data, and it's implemented using spray caching, which was really, really well. And with that improvement, we managed to reduce the whole time from 40 seconds, blocking the server, even, to under 1 second for the whole two requests. Another thing we have to do is we have the question is how do we synchronize the graph database with the MongoDB storage? So we have something called the delta updates. When a new rating is done, when you rate a movie, we store it in a collection, and that collection works like a queue. We just store there everything that needs to be updated in the graph. So whenever you ask the recommendations engine for a new recommendation, it will check first if there's an update needed in the queue and process that first. Right now we are looking for any update pending, but you could do more complex approach where you could check, for example, if that pending update it's meaningful to you or not, if it's in your network, for example, in your contacts or not, before applying it. So that's how the delta updates work. We put it in the queue, and then from the recommendations engine, we check if there's something pending, we apply it, collect the IDs, and send the response. And there's another thing that is important in this case is how do you reload the data into the graph. So the first thing here is we create a new instance of Neo4j. We import the data from MongoDB. And then we do a hot swap, meaning the application is using the old graph. And once we are finished with the new graph, we just point it to the new database. So this allows us to do massive updates on the primary database, because sometimes they go and change. They add a lot of new titles or translated titles or whatever, and they want to do really massive updates on the whole database of movies and TV shows. That way, we can reconstruct the graph really, really quickly. And we only store here really the content-related data and the user. So we don't store the titles and everything. We just store the movies, the ratings, and the relationship between users and movies and so on. So if the title of a movie changes, it doesn't affect the graph, actually. So the way we see it here is in this approach, and is we have used the graph database actually some sort of an index. The way you use Solr or Elasticsearch to do powerful queries on text, we have used Neo4j for doing powerful queries on relationships. There were a few design decisions that I think are meaningful here. We chose to only copy the subsets of the data into the graph, meaning there's nothing in the graph that is could get lost if it breaks down or anything. If we want to, we can always rebuild it from scratch. We can rebuild the graph thus with no downtime. Meaning, if the graph crashes, or you have the downtime. But if the graph is still up, we can do we can update the whole graph and everything with no downtime. And we can do massive updates. It takes a few seconds actually to rebuild the whole graph from scratch. And we have less critical pieces. I mean, it's still if Neo4j fails, obviously the user is not going to get any recommendations, but I don't have to worry about the data which is stored inside Neo4j. It's not saying I'm not I don't find Neo4j reliable, but I have to worry about less pieces in my software which are really, really critical. So now about the tools, we used Ruby and MongoDB for the main API, and for us it's just for our background, coming from web development mainly in Ruby, was for us the best decision we could take. I think it's very maintainable, it's very flexible, because being schema free means the guys are all the time changing the schema of the movies and TV shows and everything, and it's really complex and deep with lots of nested levels and so on, and that's something that we could that we couldn't model really well in Neo4j because of the restrictions it has on the properties, and it wouldn't be also a good fit for a relational database, because we would have a lot of different joins, tables, and so on. So I think for MongoDB, that's being schema-free was really, really good. And Ruby for us is because it's very maintainable and flexible, readable, and so on. But it's also because of our background. So when they want new features, usually those features are located in the main API and not graph related. That means we can pump them in a few days, and it's really fast. And if it would be in Java or anything else, it would take us longer. And regarding the recommendations, for Scala, we get a very, very nice performance, much better than Ruby, actually. And it has a very good interface for Neo4j. We can use the core API or anything to access the database. And it also, we're using Spray for the backend, which is really good, and it's asynchronous, and it's connected to a bus, and so on. So you can hang new backends onto the bus if you want. If you need more power on the graph side, you could connect more nodes to this Akka. Spray sits on top of Akka, which is a bus, and you can hang on more nodes, and they just respond to the request and so on. And that's really powerful and performant. And Neo4j was a good fit because it was a graph problem. Recommendations were clearly a graph problem, and we want to exploit the graph really well. And I think I've gone too fast because I'm already finished, but maybe you have some questions. I'll be glad to answer.
So, thank you.
Benchmarks.
No, figures. Volume.
Volume.
Volume of data or request you under with your architecture.
Not really. The database is not so big. I mean, people were talking about before about 500,000 nodes and so on. We don't have that much data. We are in the order of tens of thousands of titles, so it's under 100,000. So it's not that much. And we are about to launch, so all data we have is from simulations we have done with lots of ratings, simulating thousands of users. But we're getting a really high throughput on the Scala backend. Obviously, the Ruby backend is slower, and right now we would need to add more to scale it up by adding more machines and so on, more. Power and yeah.
Do you attempt to pre-compute any of the recommendations? You know, as you're entering data into the graph, do you say, well, that looks connected, or do you just wait till the request comes in and then explore the connection?
We wait. It's a bit, I'm not allowed to disclose a lot about the algorithm on the recommendations.
Huh? Nothing.
But we wait really. We do it in real time. So it's traversal. It's done on the core API, not on ciphers. That means we, as we saw before, we get a really much better performance. But we really calculate the recommendations on real time.
More questions? Are there recommendations down to shortcuts? Not only the movie, but the part of the movie shortcuts?
No. We don't. Right now, we recommend movies or TV shows, and we filter out those that you already have watched or series that you already follow, so TV shows that you already follow. Then it means if you're watching The Walking Dead, we won't recommend you The Walking Dead. We don't go yet into the detail of a specific episode or and so on. So that would we could add that data to the graph, but we don't do it yet.
Did you extract the metadata of the movie?
So for the graph, you mean?
Yeah.
I cannot talk much about that. Some data. Some data. The ones that we think would be useful for making a recommendation.
What would be the first improvement you would require from the Scala Spray backend? That's the first question. Second question, when are you releasing on Android?
Good point.
Yeah, I'll answer the second one first because it's easier for me. So this is client work. That means we do the back end and those guys do the front end. So it's not in my hands when to release a new client or whatever. I don't know their plans to release. If they plan to release a web client or an Android, I can figure out that it might be interesting to them, but I don't know yet. I don't know the exact roadmap for the product. And for the first, you asked about which improvement to do in, which would be the next improvement to do in the Scala backend.
In the Scala Casper combination, where are the major pains? What would you want to see improved, if any?
Right now we're happy. I mean, the other situation was really painful because having the Ruby server block, it was just, 40 seconds wasted and the other guys waiting for the request to be processed, and that was really not a nice solution. So Spray is really good because it sits on Akka, and you can if we have to scale up, yeah, definitely is the way to go. And it's the load balancing, for example, you just send it to you don't forward it just to one server. You send a message on a bus, and the backends that are available for to process that request, they send a response saying, I'll catch it, I'll process it. So it's really much more advanced than doing just plain standard load balancing or stuff like that. Much more complex than an advanced that you would do, for example, doing load balancing on Ruby backends.
Can you explain a bit how have you implemented the recommendation system on Neo4j? If you use the Aentos rating for the users, if you know user relation about friends, about some things of this, if you can explain a bit.
The problem is because the algorithm on the graph is like the core of the app, they don't want it to disclose it for now. But we definitely store the relation between user and movies that you have rated, obviously. We have some other data that we store that we think might be useful to store it, and that's it. We don't go through contacts right now. You can suggest a movie to a contact, that's it. Or you can see what your contacts have watched, etc., and so on. But that's not really related to the recommendations right now. Okay. We might use that data after later.
Why not storing everything in Neo4j, and you decide for a double?
Yes, we thought about that, but
there must be some good reason.
or not. Well, first of all, for us, it's one of the first apps that we did on Neo4j. So I think coming from other databases, it might be something that you be more fearful about. But also, there's certain restrictions on the attributes that you can use on nodes. So if you are using an array, you cannot mix up data with another array, and so on. So the data types that you have are pretty restricted. And then they have the other guys which are messing all the time around the schema of the movies. So they're changing it all the time. Now we want to include the cast. Now I want to include this. Now I want to remove that. So we let them even play. We let them even change the whole movies collection as long as they don't touch the fields that we are using. We let them update it completely. So that would be much more painful for us on Neo4j. So they have developed their own client for the MongoDB on top of the MongoDB REST API, and they play around with it. And as long as they don't break anything, they can do with the schema what they want. And with Neo4j, it would be much more restrictive.
Can you say something about the accuracy of this recommendation system? How accurate
it is? They didn't benchmark between this and other websites or recommendation engines that work like this?
Yeah. Our
it was also my question, so.
Okay.
We've tried it ourselves,
yeah.
And I think we're really happy with the results.
Okay, that's the same that Peter told about the benchmarking.
But how do you benchmark that? How do you benchmark? I don't know much about that. How do you benchmark the results for recommendations engine? I mean, what do you expect? What do you expect to it
well,
to
sort of a survey like on some amount of users?
We haven't done yet.
No.
We did it at small scale,
okay.
Informally.
Okay.
The quality of the users, so if the user is happy with your recommendation, if you just recommend me, I don't know, if I like CSI and you just pop up to me another episode of CSI, it's not good quality recommendation. You know?
Yeah.
It's stupid things like that.
No, the results for now are informally good. People haven't complained about the results, but we have not proceeded in a structured way on doing this. I mean, as long as they're happy, it's okay. And the next step would be maybe evaluate that and see which improvements we can make. But I think it's very subjective. Like, you go to any site recommending movies.
It's a lot of statistics. Last questions, and then I book the last one.
Yes, I had a similar project using the project with Ruby, was already built, and when I launched it, I had performance issues, so I had to cancel it. My question is, I don't know about the Scala and implementation, how would be the learning curve to implement that in Scala?
I don't think I got it.
Learning curve of implementing something like you did
in Scala.
From Ruby to Scala.
Well, we only didn't move almost any bit. So we started from the beginning having the two backends, because we knew accessing the doing the stuff we want to do on a graph from Ruby was going to be painful. For me, I've been learning Scala now for a while. I'm not the main developer by the end of the backend in Scala. I don't know enough Scala to do that, but I've been learning Scala. The learning curve is a bit hard at the beginning, but to me, coming from Ruby, it feels really nice. It's readable code, it's shorter, it's low ceremony. I feel the hard work is really coming from the Ruby side, especially, it's really nice. If you have long experience doing Java, there's no point in learning Scala only for that. But if you want the power from the JVM and access Java libraries and so on, and then Scala is definitely a good fit. But apart from that, it's a very personal thing.
So thank you very much. And then offline we do the hours.
Okay. Thank you.